Everybody give them a nice hand. Amen. I decided last night my costume, I was going to use my Halloween costume this morning. I'm dressing like a Pentecostal TV evangelist. Did you recognize me? That's best I got. Amen. Turn around and smile at your neighbor and say, neighbor, we're going to have a good time in the church today. I'm going to be in the book of Job, a word that the government does not understand, or the book of Job. And in the book of Job, we're going to start in the first chapter today. And a couple of days ago, I was reading a really super good book that I've had for a number of years, since the late 70s. And it's written by a comedian, a little Jewish girl. Her name is Gilda Radner. And the name of the book is It's Always Something. If it ain't one thing, it's another. And I never found anybody could argue with that. Never found a theologian that didn't agree with that. And everybody in your own life, I imagine you have experienced the same feeling. If it ain't one thing, it's another. If it's not this, it's going to be something else. It's always something. And so I thought I'd preach on that today, and about somebody that actually probably knew a lot about this. Because everything always seemed to happen to him, and everything bad you can write happening to anybody, it happened to him. I'm amazed that this has not been turned into a movie. Job's life was extraordinary. And let me read just a little bit of this, because we live right now in a world full of trouble and problems. And then problems come right after problems. My wife and I decided that the news media and the government work together to keep everybody upset about something all the time. They don't want you to get together. They're trying to tear this country apart. The way I know that to be true is because a very wise man, his name was, I'll think of it in a minute. He was a preacher that came up to me and he said, you know, there's profit in confusion. And I said, I believe you're right. The more confused you can make somebody, the better off it is for somebody that's in charge. And so you have people today that I believe that are intent on keeping everybody upset about something. And if you have a Facebook account, you probably know that to be true. You can say praise the Lord and have 50 people come on there and tell you you're out of your mind, you're nuts, you're crazy. How can you say praise the Lord now? But you better learn to praise the Lord. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, you better learn how to praise the Lord. There was a man in the land of Uz. We don't know how old this book is, because this book was written before Moses. Before Moses wrote Genesis, the first five books of the Bible, this book was already in existence, whose name was Job, and that man was perfect and upright, and one that feared God and eschewed or despised evil. And there were born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters. His substance also was 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 she-asses, and a very great household. So that this man was the greatest of all the men of the east. Doesn't say east of what, but east. And his sons went and feasted in their houses, every one his day, and sent and called for their 3 sisters to eat and to drink with them. And it was so, when the days of their feasting were gone about, that Job sent and sanctified them, and rose up early in the morning, and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus did Job continually. So not only was Job worried about himself and his own family, or his wife, but he was also worried about his children. He was a good man. Now, this is how I know that Shakespeare may have translated this. Because of this line right here. Now, there was a day. Sounds just like one of his writings. When the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. Whoa. Satan came to church? I guess so. And the Lord said unto Satan, he didn't talk to his sons of God. He was interested in talking to the devil here. Whence comest thou? And Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God and despiseth, escheweth evil? Then Satan answered and said to the Lord, doth Job fear God for nothing, for naught? Hast thou not made a hedge about him, and about his house, and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. But you put forth thine hand now, and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. And the Lord said unto Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power. Only upon himself put not forth thine hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. What did he do? I heard a song. I played it this morning. I wanted to remember it. It was an old blues song. Trouble, 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 trouble. That's what happened. Job also told us here in this book here that a man's days are few and they're filled with trouble. So he's telling us right here, we're going to be here just a short while, and I can tell you right now that I'm 71 years old, but it seems like I was 18 yesterday. I turned around and said, what? What happened? But things will happen to you. But we know one thing here. Now listen to this. This tells us something, and sometimes you have to think between the lines here. A man that is born of a woman is but for a few days and full of trouble. In other words, this tells us that God sets limits. God has numbered the days of your life. In other words, I'm telling you right now, you're not going to die until God gets ready. And if God gets ready, you don't want to stay here anyhow. Amen. You say that's kind of more fatalistic. No, it's believing what God has done. God's sovereign. He's in charge. God is set a number of days. Even David said in the Psalms, teach us to number our days, O Lord, which actually tells us that our days are numbered. And I don't want to live any longer than God wants me to be here, but the devil can't kill me until God gets ready. If he can, then. I don't know if he can or not. And since our days are numbered, it also means, and God has set this time, that God also is aware of the trials and tribulations that are coming to us, and we have to realize that every trial and every trouble and every problem that arises, it has a set time on it. It's going to be temporary. It's not going to be forever. In other words, trials and tribulations, even though they may not be new to us, and we've all met some of them in our life, I very seldom meet anybody that said, well, nothing bad's ever happened to me. Almost every, and you ask them if they say that, and then you find out some really terrible things have happened in their life. It seems like every time you get ready, as anybody, do you pay your bills all at one time for the month? Or do you just pay them as they come in? How many don't even pay your bills? Come by and see me. I got to learn that one. Hallelujah. But it seems to me every time, you know, I kind of save them up. I kind of, because it's a mortality day for me, but I let all the bills stack up there and I got them in order and I got to pay them, and then I'll pay them one day, and then when I get them all in the mail, take them to the post office, stamp them all, and then when I come back and open the mailbox out here in front, I got a whole bunch more of them. It's like they knew. That postman must be working for the devil or something. This is really bad. When I start thinking about how bad things are, you know how I came into this world? I came into this world and I didn't want to leave where I was. And that nurse, the Frontier Nursing Association, she pulled me up by my ankles and slapped me. The first thing that happened to me is somebody slapped me. I guess it was good for me. It made me start breathing, but it let me know something. This world that I was born into is a world full of trouble and pain. Pain and sorrow is going to come to you. The doctor hits you and you haven't even done anything. After all, you're just a baby. But you found out from that day on, or I have, that no matter what happens with people, situations, circumstances, they keep kind of hitting me. And I haven't gotten used to it yet. And I haven't done anything to deserve any of it. I know some of you don't going to disagree with that, because you think that everything has cause and effect, that you did something. The first thing that somebody asked me, said when something went wrong in their life, they said, Brother Ross, I don't know what I ever did to deserve this. What did I do wrong? And the truth is, you have an adversary named the devil. The devil is sitting around right now trying to figure out what to do to you next. And you say, I didn't do anything. You don't have to do anything to get the devil mad at you. He's mad at you because you're a child of God. Listen, I want to interject something here. Christians are not Hindus and we're not Buddhists. What's happening to me right now is not a result of what I did in a past life. Amen. And I'm not going to have a result of this life in a future life somewhere, when I either come back as a this or come back as that. The truth is, Christians don't live that way and don't believe that way. And so therefore, this idea that something you have done right now, listen, I'm going to knock this generational curse right out of your mind. What's happening to you is not a result of what your grandpappy did somewhere in the old country. They teach that. I'm going to tell you, the generational curse that I was under, I got it from Adam. Not my grandfather, huh? And neither did you. It came all the way down from the beginning. And when you accept Jesus Christ, it curses that. It ends that. It stops that. There is no generational curse. This is another lie that the devil has brought into the church to convince people that it's something you did wrong that makes you the way you are right now. And the truth is, when you become a child of God, that is not so. Well, I've heard this all of my life. Well, the reason you're that way is because look at your daddy and his family. My daddy and his family had nothing to do with the way I turned out. Ain't none of them preachers. They all horse thieves and moonshiners and dope dealers. Hallelujah. Living down there still feuding with the Hatfields and All the Hatfields been gone out of that area of the country for 100 years, but they're looking for somebody. The truth is, child of God, I didn't turn out like that. I didn't turn out like my natural daddy, my real daddy, a lowlife. I got principles. And the only way I got those is I got them from the Lord. I was born again. How about you? When you're born again, old things are passed away and all things have become new. That means that when that happened and I become a child of God, every time the devil looks at me, he sees God. Just like he looked at Job and said, does Job serve you for nothing? You just take your hand off of him and I'll make him curse you to your face. I'll make him curse God and die. The devil may have said the same thing to God about you. Listen now. This lets you know how on a different page here I am from most of the faith teaching in this world. Because listen, child of God, you and I know this one thing. You don't have to do anything to make the devil mad at you. Let me tell you something else. You don't have to do anything to make God deliver you. Because God knows coming in and the going out. God knows what happens all the time. God knows what when you get up in the morning, knows when and when you didn't set your clock. God knows all about that. God knows exactly what is happening to us right now. And you say, well, how can he keep track of so many people? Why is God mindful of me? That is a thought that is interjected into us by the devil. That God's so busy up there keeping Jupiter from running into Mars that he doesn't know what's happening into our life. But I promise you right now, God knows everything. God knows everything about everybody. God knows exactly what happened to you last night and what you're getting ready to do today. God knows everything. He counts the hair on your head. He knows when you feel good. He knows what's going on in your body. He knows how to heal it. He made it. Hallelujah. We don't have to send you back to the factory because the factory goes with you everywhere you go. God is with you no matter what the devil tries to do about you. God is with you right now. And you say, well, I haven't done anything to make all of this evil come against me. You don't have to do anything. Evil is coming. Trouble is coming. The devil knows he has a limited time also. The devil already knows that he can only work a certain amount of time. Listen carefully now. The devil has come down among you having great wrath because he knoweth he hath but a short time. How many years does he have in your life? The appointed years that God has. He has to work on you and destroy you in the time that you have been given. Ain't no trying to raise you from the dead and take you to hell afterwards. Hallelujah. The devil has to trick you and deceive you and lie to you now while you're alive in the land of the living. The devil is after you now. Not going to be after you die. He's after you now. The devil is trying to destroy every one of us right now in this present life. And if we will start listening to him, then it's going to compound the trouble that we have. Just like when you pay the doctor bill, here comes a bill from the water man. Ain't one thing, it's another. Every time, it's always something. The devil knows what he's doing too. And if the devil is not using your spouse, the devil is using your children. And if the devil's not using your children, he's going to try to speak through your neighbors. Come on, church, you need to say amen. And one of the reasons that the devil's purpose is to make us think that God is not mindful of us and God does not care about us and God is not a loving God, that God's too busy in order to pay attention to us, that he is not merciful enough. Everybody look at me right now. I'm going out on a limb here because this is different than what most of the Pentecostals teach. Listen carefully.
God knows what you're going through. God knows when you raise up in the morning. God knows how much faith you already have in your heart. So the God that I'm serving is not trying to do you in.
Instead, if anything, God's trying to increase your faith, not weaken us. God's trying to make us stronger. Like the nurse paddled me when I was born in the first few seconds. There was a reason for that. Sometimes we need a little paddling. Upside our heads. Amen. We need one of those, what they call in Michigan, a shakabuku. That's a spiritual kick to the head to get your attention. It has to be spiritual. What I'm saying to you, child of God, don't you let these faith teachers tell you that, hold on now, listen carefully, that the reason you're in trouble is because you did not have enough faith. I can tell you a good story right now. My mother, who was probably closer to God than the pastor of the church was, but they had a teaching there that if you went to a doctor, you were trusting in the devil, the arm of flesh. You weren't trusting in God if you went to a doctor. Well, my mother worked as a domestic. That means she cleaned house for a doctor. And one day while she was there, she fell out. She passed out. And the doctor walked in and said, "Ruth, Ruth," and grabbed her hand and started patting on her hand and then called an ambulance. My mother didn't call an ambulance. She didn't go see a doctor, but she found herself in the hospital. Did you know something? None of those faith healers would come and see her. You want to know why? Because if she had any faith, she wouldn't be there in the first place. What a cop-out that is. How many times have I heard faith healers tell people the reason you didn't get healed is because you don't have enough faith? Can I tell you something, child of God? Huh? We put too much emphasis on the wrong thing. We put emphasis on faith instead of putting emphasis on Jesus. We talk about how much faith somebody doesn't have and don't talk about how much Jesus they don't have. If you got Jesus in your life, it doesn't matter to me what the devil brings against me, and no matter what time of day it is, with Jesus on the inside, I'm not afraid of anything that the devil can do to me. I wish somebody would say amen on that. If you have Jesus on the inside of you, this should make you very happy today, because the devil cannot destroy you. God is the only one that can put a period at the end of your sentence. God is the only one that can end this. God is the only one in charge of this. The devil is not in charge. I know nobody wants to believe that, because if they didn't have a real powerful devil ruling over the prince and the power of the air, if they didn't have that going for them, they wouldn't know how to preach. But me, I know I'm serving an all-powerful God. My God made everything there is. My God made the beginning. He's going to make the end. God made everything in between. He raises up and he lays down. My God is the one who is the first and not the last. He's the beginning and not the end. He's the greatest. He's not the least. The God that I serve is in control of everything. I am not a pawn in the hands of the devil. I have given my life to Jesus Christ. I'm not being controlled by the circumstances of this world. You say, "Oh, Brother Ross, bad times are coming." What's that to me? Isaiah said, "I will not fear, though the mountains crumble down and the earth be removed from beneath my feet. I know in whom I have believed, and my Redeemer liveth." You need to understand something here. I'm a child of God. I'm not afraid of anything that man can do to me, and I'm not afraid of anything that the devil can pull and try to do against us. We are God's children. We're the head and not the tail. We're the first and not the last. We're the greatest and not the least. We have the power of God living on the inside of us. And when I say the name of Jesus, demons tremble. You too, not just me. And so the devil usually doesn't try to get through me. What the devil usually tries to do is hinder through something else. And if it ain't one thing, it's another. If the devil doesn't try to do it one thing. I just thought of a song. I was preaching in Oakland, California, me and Renard, if you remember him. We're out there playing, and this lady came to, she was a sweetheart. I remember her name well. Her name was Fanny Walker. And her middle initial was J. The first time she said her name, my name is Fanny J. Walker. I thought, that's funny, J. Walker. And she came to service a few times. She said, Brother Ross, do you ever let anybody testify? I said, yeah, I do. I said, you want to testify? She said, yeah. She said, can I sing a song? I said, yeah. I mean, why not? And she goes, so she got up, and she's the only person I've ever been in church with that gave a title to her testimony. What happened to me on my way to church by Fanny J. Walker. I love that girl right away. Amen. And so, but she wrote a song. She said, I want to sing a song for you this morning. I said, okay. You want to hear her song? If it ain't one thing, it's another. She got really Bessie Griffin on that. If it ain't one thing, it's another. If it ain't one thing, it's another. I know all the words. If it ain't one thing, it's another. Another verse. If it ain't your mother, it's your brother. And then you know how the rest of the song went. If it ain't one thing, it's another. The truth is, child of God, it's true. Many times we get up and we go through one thing, and the very minute we get through one battle, it seems that another one is facing us. But here we have a great problem here. Here's a man who is righteous. He was perfect. He was upright. He was successful. He had money. Here is a man that had everything going for him, and he's in the Bible here, everything exactly the way he wanted it. Rich, the richest man in the East. He had everything that this life could possibly offer, and he feared God. You know, the money didn't make him a sinner. He had money, but he was righteous. And so here he feared God, he loved God, and despised. But God said to the devil, I'm going to brag on somebody this morning. I'm going to brag on my servant Job. Have you considered him? And the devil said, well, you have put a hedge about him. I can't even get to him. I can't even touch him. I can't even. And I thought, my Lord, that's where I want to be. I want to be serving God. So the devil and all of his, they can't even touch me. But there may come a day. You see that? I remember that. I read that. Now, there was a day. All right, it says it again. It says it down here in verse 13. And there was a day. In other words, we know that sometimes when God has put a set time on our life and a set time on the number of our days, and God has this in mind for us, that some days God may let the devil do the best he can. Take your best shot. You may not believe that, but I've been there. Devil took his best shot at me, and he probably took his best shot at you, whether you know it or not. The devil is probably, what's he holding back for? Well, devil ain't your friend. Why would the devil try to say, well, I'm not going to touch him today because, you know, they're blessed of God? No, if you're blessed of God, you're the one the devil's after. The more blessing from God you get, the madder the devil is going to get at you. Are you going through trouble right now? I got good news for you. You must be doing all right because you're still holding on to the Lord. Come on, say amen. Devil tried to kill some of you, but you still believe.
Devil robbed all your money, but you're still believing in God. The devil tried to take your children away from you, but you held on anyhow, and you're still praying and you're still believing. And if mother went and daddy went and you don't have parents anymore, you're still believing in God. Think about that. You ought to say, yeah, devil. Look at this. I'm still holding on, and no matter what the devil tries to do to me, I'm going to hold on to God, Brother Sims. I'm not going to turn loose no matter what happens. And you know, when God hears that determination in your heart, and he knows that, and the devil knows more than God, God already knows the end from the beginning. He knows you're going to stand the test. Can anybody say amen? Whatever you're going through right now, God already knows you're going to make it. God knows you're going to stand the test. So you need to get that pressure off of you. God has not lost confidence in you because the devil is attacking you. Instead, God may have been bragging on you. Have you considered my servant Ross? Have you considered my servant Kevin? Have you considered my servant Brother Sims and Brother Ray and Brother Daryl? God may have been bragging on you. Hey, look here, devil. Here's somebody who will stand the test. I don't care what you bring against them. I love them so much, and they're serving me so much, they're always going to serve me. Woo! Hallelujah. Makes me feel good down in my soul. Because I know the devil bragged on me a few times. I have a friend down in Florida. He's dying of AIDS right now. And I talked to his son. And his son said to me, I said, you think God's keeping him alive? And he said, no, the devil's keeping him alive. I said, I don't know if he can do that. God has a set time. God has a set time for you. And so no matter what happens in your life, you know right now that whatever the devil is doing, it's temporary. The devil cannot take your life. The devil cannot overcome you. It's temporary. And so you know there's going to be an end to this. And God alone knows the end from the beginning. I'm going to tell you something about the devil I have found. The devil doesn't mind if you sing in the choir. The devil doesn't mind if you come to church. The devil doesn't mind if you join hands in the prayer meeting. The devil doesn't mind if you preach a sermon. The devil doesn't mind if you come to church. He'll come to church with you on Sunday. Sometimes I felt when I preached in my lifetime that I had more devils in the service than I did righteous people. But it didn't change anything that God was going to do. If every demon worshiper in all of Michigan, and every witch, and every Wiccan, and every one of these Gothic people all came out here and joined hands and doubted, it wouldn't change one thing that God does, because God don't pay no mind to what the devil's doing. God knows the devil is going to do evil. You need to understand this too. Hallelujah. The devil will come to church with you and turn into a gossiper. The devil will come to church with you and tell lies about somebody else in the church. The devil will come to you and, what will he do? He'll tell you that ain't real, that ain't true, that's not so. God don't move that way. God doesn't act that way. This is not a real church. He'll sit there and tell you that these people are not of God. God doesn't intend things to be, but that's the devil talking. If you're a believer, you're going to catch on to some faith here today, and you're going to realize that God knows exactly where you are, knows your name. He knows who your comforters are. At AA, they call them enablers. Someone that'll go drink with you. Oh, honey, just have one drink. It's all right. One drink won't hurt you when you know it's going to kill you. The devil is like that. He'll send you enablers. In the Bible, here in the book of Job, they're called Job's comforters. People who had come out to give him comfort, but all they meant was evil to Job. They were all jealous of him. I'm going to tell you right now, anybody that comes and tells you some bad news about somebody you love, they're not your friend. Anybody that wants to be detrimental about the things of God and say, I'm doing this for your own good, they're not your friend. The devil sent them to you. The devil is a liar. Does anybody know that beside me? The devil is a liar. What's he going to tell you? The truth? The devil's going to tell you a lie because he's a liar. The truth is not in him. How can he tell the truth? Job was an actual real man. He lived on this earth. He was a real person. He had devotion to God. He was a rich man, and he did everything exactly right, did nothing wrong. He avoided, he despised evil. He was a good man. He did good to his neighbors. He did good to people, and he watched out for his sons, and he watched out for his daughters, and he made sacrifices to God for them just in case they had sinned against God and didn't know what to do about it. I'm going to tell you right now, here was a good man, but trouble came to him from every side. Look how it came. It's all written right here in the first chapter. Huh? Now there was a day when his sons and his daughters were eating, verse 13, and drinking wine in the, eliminate that from the King James Version. In their eldest brother's house, and there came a messenger unto Job and said, the oxen were plowing and the asses feeding beside them, and the Sabians fell upon them and took them all away. They have slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only am escaped alone to tell thee.
Bad news. He lost one third of his livestock at one time, plus his servants at one time. That's like the stock market crashing. This is bad news. This is wealth that he lost and was stolen from him. And why? Listen. If it ain't one thing, here comes the other. And while he was yet speaking, there came also another servant and said, the fire of God is fallen from heaven and hath burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them, and I am the only one left alive to come back and tell you this story. Huh. Ain't one thing. That's two things. Now here's another. And while he was yet speaking, there came also another. The Chaldeans made out three bands and fell upon the camels and have carried them all away. Yea, and have slain thy servants with the edge of the sword, and I only am escaped to come and tell thee. In other words, the devil let one person go back and tell the story each time. And listen, it's not over yet. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, thy sons and thy daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house, and behold, there came a great wind from the wilderness and smote the four corners of the house, and it fell upon the young men, and they're all dead. But I alone am escaped to come and tell you. The devil will always have somebody come and tell you. The bad news, they're telling you the bad news is how the devil operates. He wouldn't have if he couldn't come to you and tell you something bad to upset your life. And listen, I'm going to tell you, there's some upset here. This man lost all of his wealth in a period of a few hours, and not only that, his sons and his daughters are all dead too. Instead of going out and making an offering to God, now he's got 12 or 10 coffins sitting there, and the servants are all dead. He has nobody. He has nobody at all except four servants that came to him and gave him bad news. How would you like to lose everything in a day? Here's Job. And Job, the word of God said, listen, he did not charge God foolishly. He didn't get mad at God. He didn't say, God, why have you done this to me? You've left me. Oh, that's what the devil wanted him to say. He did not charge God foolishly and say, the reason this happened to me is because, well, God must be a mean God. God's an angry God. This is where the devil wants you to get at. Look at all these, I'm sorry, I don't want to use bad language about them. Look at all these people who were in church at one time, and somebody said something to them, and now they're mad at every Christian and mad at God and mad at everybody. They're mad at the Pope when he came. They just got mad at everybody.
all because of something bad that happened to them while they were in church. How stupid. They charged God foolishly. They're blaming God for something that they themselves saw, and because they saw one act, they think God is the one responsible for it. Don't you know that your adversary is the devil? Hadn't anybody told them that the devil is responsible for this? That it's not God who has done evil, it's the devil who has done evil. Sometimes God steps back and said, devil, I am so proud of this person and their faith in me that they are my child and my son and my daughter, that you can do anything that you want to them, but they're never going to get upset at me. They're going to love me through every trouble that comes along. And so Job said, when he had nothing left, he tore his clothes. Why keep that old rag? Everything else is gone. Put ashes in his hair, a sign of grief. And he sat down on an ash heap, and he said, look, naked was I when I came from my mother's womb. They slapped me too, just like they do everybody else. I knew life was going to be hard. But listen, the Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Listen, I want everybody here right now to raise both hands and say, blessed be the name of the Lord. You can bless him for every trial and every trouble you've ever gone through, and everybody that lied on you, everybody that cheated you, everybody that did you wrong, they robbed you, whatever they did, you can still raise your hands up and say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm still going to praise God. If I'm standing here a millionaire, I'm going to stand and praise God. If I haven't got nothing but the clothes on my back, it doesn't change my relationship with God. If I'm on the mountaintop or down in the valley, I still love the Lord. Hallelujah, because he heard my cry and he pitied every groan. I love the Lord here today. When I'm rich, I love the Lord, and I've been poor. I've lost everything more than one time. Sitting there living like everything was great and good, and then lose it in a matter of weeks. I know exactly what that is. I know the feeling. I know. And listen, I got mad too. I blamed everybody I ever knew. You'd think I was running for political office. Amen. I blame my Sunday school. It's her fault. Listen, you know what she told me? I blamed everybody. I blamed everybody but the devil. Listen, I forgive everybody everything, but I blame the devil for everything. I don't hold it against you. Somebody came to me and said, well, Brother Ross, don't you get mad when people talk? No, I get mad at the devil, but I was mad at the devil before they come in the door. I've always been mad at the devil. I'm mad at the devil right now. Hallelujah. I want the devil to be destroyed, because the devil is a liar, and he attacks God's people, and many of God's people don't understand that it. Instead, they want to think of everything else. Hallelujah. I want you to understand something. The devil will let you go through your normal life, interjecting just one little thought here and one little thought there. You'll go through, and suddenly the devil will convince you that the reason that all of these bad things are happening to you is because you got bad genetics, it's a generational curse, it's because of something you did and you need to get forgiveness of it, it's because you don't have enough faith, or it's because you're not holy enough. And I'm going to tell you right now, when the devil attacks you, it's because you're holy. It's not because you're a sinner. It's because you've been living for God. It's not because the devil ain't going to attack somebody living for the devil. He's already got them. What's he want them for? He doesn't have to mess with them. He wants to mess with you, because you're still holding on to God and trusting in God and believing in God, and you're not going to give up, and you're not going to turn around. You're not going to go back to what you came out of. You're going to hold on to God. Though the way may be hard, hallelujah, you're still going to hold on to God anyhow. You're going to cry sometime. I wouldn't give you a dime for a Christian that don't know how to cry. But I know one thing, weeping may endure for the night, But we know that joy is coming. Hallelujah. We know that joy is going to come in the morning when Jesus gets here. Hallelujah. Devil don't mind you singing. He don't mind you listening to your little gospel songs. He doesn't mind you saying, praise the Lord, as you go down the highway. The devil is afraid of one thing. Listen. He's afraid when you get down on your knees and start calling on God. He's afraid when you start praying the prayer of faith. He's afraid when you start calling those things that are not as though they are. He's afraid when you make a stand for God against evil in this world. When you won't go along with it. When you won't participate in it. Hallelujah. You and I know that God is on our side because God is in us. God is not a house divided. When God moves on the inside of you, He's ready to take on all comers that come your way. We have something that Job never had. You want to know what it is? We have the Holy Ghost living down in our heart. We have something. What if Job had had the Holy Ghost? This book may have been different from the beginning. But we know one thing for sure, that if the devil comes against you, and he is coming, when the devil sees the Holy Ghost in you, listen carefully. When the Holy Ghost sees, or the devil sees the Holy Ghost in you, what he's going to do is say, ain't no use me fooling around with them. That's where the devil got with me. He don't bother me all that much no more. Hallelujah. Devil don't even come into my church anymore. I used to have some devils show up here every once in a while. We cast them out. Now, you full of the devil and you open your car door. Half my church members will attack you. Hallelujah. Come out of there, Lucia. Come on out of here. Hallelujah. More devils get cast out in my parking lot than in most churches in town. Come on, say amen. Ain't no use fooling around with me. You know why? God, the devil may say this, and the Holy Ghost is that hedge about us. The Holy Ghost in our heart builds a fence around us. Do you know how many times you could have been hurt, but the Holy Ghost stepped in? Do you know how many times you could have lost, but the Holy Ghost stepped in? You know how many times evil could have come your way, but the Holy Ghost stepped in? You're walking in the Holy Ghost now. When you walk into our room, the devil has to run away. Hallelujah. Because he knows you're there, and the Holy Ghost ain't going to take no mess from nobody. Come on, say amen. Especially the devil. The Holy Ghost will not take anything from the devil. And when the devil comes against you, the Holy Ghost on the inside of you is going to rise up. When the devil comes in, the Holy Ghost will raise up a standard against him. The devil had everybody misquoting that scripture. When the Holy Ghost comes in when the devil comes in like a flood. No, God's the flood. Come on, say amen. Job said God rode in a whirlwind. He rode in a windstorm. Hallelujah. When God comes, everything else backs up. When Jesus comes, the devil's power is broken. When Jesus gets in your heart, everything changes around you. Hallelujah. When Jesus comes into your heart and you turn your life over to God, you'll find out that friends that you thought were going to be with you forever don't even want to talk to you anymore. I found one of my friends on Facebook from high school, and I sent him a little message, and I said, hey, Jim, this is Ross. Give me I just saw your picture here. I want to know how you are. And he wrote back one question. Are you still a preacher? That was it. That did it. He's out of here. Hallelujah. That's the way he left me when in junior high school. The night I got the Holy Ghost, the next day he didn't want to have anything to do with me anymore. Listen, the devil is mad at you. Don't you understand that? The devil wants to destroy you, but the devil can't do it. Even if you got 10 caskets sitting here and you've lost everybody that you've ever loved in your life and that God has given to you, and you know God has given your children to you, if you've lost them all and you've lost your business, lost your money, lost your house, somebody came crying to me and said, oh, Brother Ross, I lost my job. I don't know what we're going to do. I said, you're going to trust God. What?
trust God. Some of you trust in that check you getting. What if you don't get it no more? What you gonna do then? Huh? Answer me that. Come on, say amen. Well, I got my pension. I got my Social Security. It ain't social and it ain't secure, but they call it that. Come on, say amen. If you didn't get that, what in the world would you do? If you didn't have some guarantees, well, I've worked, now I want my money. Hallelujah. Huh? And what if they didn't do it? That's like everybody on Social Security. Worked all your life, paid into it. Now they're saying they ain't going to give it all back to you. Who are they going to give it to? They took it. What are they doing with it? Whose money is it? It's my money. They're going to share it with who? People that never paid anything in? That ain't right. But God didn't tell me everything was going to be all right. God told me your days are few and full of trouble. That's what the Lord told me. You better get ready for it. Hallelujah. If you put your trust in man, you're going to be disappointed. If you put your trust in checks, they're going to disappoint you. If you got your trust in your bank, you think that bank is your friend? Don't tell me about a friendly banker. All they want is your money. When you walk in there, all they see is a dollar sign. And if they don't see that, they ain't got no time for you. Hallelujah. I had somebody say, well, I know I got friends up here at the bar. I said, go in there and don't take any money sometime. Come on, church. You need to say amen. Well, I know my pastor loves me. Well, don't give any money for a while and see what happens. Don't talk to me. Get out of my way. Where's the keys to my Bentley? Hallelujah. Come on, church. Say amen. I need a new airline pilot. A new pilot for my plane. Hallelujah. The truth is, child of God, you have to understand something. Don't put your trust even in me. I want you to like me. I want you to love me. I want to love you. I want to love everybody. We're Christians. We ought to do that. But don't start looking at me as though I got some kind of secret potion here. I don't know no secret words. I don't have an in with God that everybody else can't get. I'm not special, that special in this world. I'm going to tell you right now, there's many people like me who've come through trouble and come through heartache and know that God will provide when you get down to no money. They know that God is a healer when you get sick in your body. They know that God will step in and change situations. There's many people like me. Perhaps you're that one like me also that knows that God is your source, that every good thing and every perfect thing cometh down from the Father of lights, in whom there's neither variableness nor shadow of turning. You have that faith. I have that faith. I have the same Holy Ghost that you have. I have the same Holy Ghost that Jesus had. Well, Jesus walked on the water. What are you going to do? Let the storms overshadow you? Wash you away? Well, Jesus calmed the waves. What are you going to do? Let them blow your house away? Come on, Job. If you'd only known about that, you could have run out there and stopped it all. Oops. I'm about to interject another thought here. You got your pencil ready? Job said, the thing that I have so greatly feared has come upon me. I got that mark somewhere. That's in here. Is that what chapter is that? Is that the fourth chapter? Takes him a while to get around to saying that. The thing that I have so greatly feared has happened. What are you afraid of today? I can start thinking of something and it'll happen. Am I that much in control of my life? I don't know, but I can start worrying about something, and there it is at the door the next day. I can start being concerned, and then all of a sudden things happen. What I've done, learned how to do is I've learned how to erase things out of my mind. Because I'm telling you right now, the Holy Ghost is the hedge about me. You want to do something to me? You got to talk to God about it first. Somebody want to do evil to you? They got to come through God to get to you. And you say, well, he lost everything. What did he do? Well, let's go over here to, let's save a lot of reading here. Let's go to the end of the book and read the last. Let's go over the end of Job here. 42 chapters. Let's get over here to 42. I started in one. Let's skip over all the small talk. Huh? 325. That's when he said, the thing that I have so greatly feared has come upon me. You get afraid of losing out with God, you'll lose out. Why? Because your thoughts are self-fulfilling. That's why I eliminate the negative and accentuate the positive, and I don't mess with anything in between. I'm sorry, this, how many like that? Was that good? You know how old that? That's not just a Johnny Mercer song back in the time when nobody had any money. That was all from a sermon by Father Divine. But I'm not trying to get you to buy a number here today. You got to accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative. What's the rest of it? Huh? But don't mess with Mr. In Between. In other words, don't get a double mind here, thinking God bless you when you got. Listen, some people believe God is blessing them when they got money. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I got enough money to pay my bill. You ought to thank Jesus for that. You should have thanked Jesus when you didn't have anything. God does not deserve your thanks when everything's going good, and not deserve it when everything's going bad. God is God. You need to love God. Listen now. This is where it ends up. Verse 10, 42:10. And the Lord turned. You see, there was a set time. God said, devil, you've had it long enough. You did everything you could. He's not going to turn his back on me. He's not going to curse me. He's going to hold on. Listen now. Listen what God did. The Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. You know what he had to do? He actually had to forgive all those people that told him bad stuff. Oh, Lord. Maybe that's why you're in a mess right now. You want to forgive people. I forgive everybody everything. I go to bed at night forgiving everybody everything. I don't want to lay there and sleep about bitterness. Amen. When I lay up on the bed, I want the Lord to give me rest and sleep. Amen. I don't want to be having nightmares and dreams about what somebody did to hurt me. How many ever have a dream about the devil chasing you? I used to have that. I said, God, you got to help me with that. And one night in my dream, I turned around and faced the devil, and he ran away. Somebody say amen. So he forgave his friends and prayed for them. And also, this is verse 10. You got to get your underlining pencil out here. Your magic marker or whatever it is. You got to underline this here. Also, by the way, the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. In other words, anything that you think the devil has taken away from you, God's going to give you double for your trouble. If it ain't one thing, well, the one thing is how the devil works. That's the one thing. But the other is how God works. And when the devil does one thing, God gives you the other. And the other is the blessing of God. Every time you have a trial, God gives you a blessing. Every time you lose, God gives you double. Every time you get sick, God gives you good health. Not only that, but he gives you another power. Listen, this is important now. When you go, you know, the thief comes not just to take what you have that he didn't earn, but he also comes to destroy and to kill. But when Jesus comes, not only is he going to give you life, but he's going to give you abundant life. It's not just a give. You look, there's living and there's living in abundance. I know the difference. Hallelujah. I've scraped and eked by many times trying to get by, but there's a difference between that than when the blessing of the Lord cometh upon you and he commands a blessing on everything you set your hand to, and God begins to reward you for things you think you did 20 years ago. Here it comes back to you with blessing in God's hands. He opens his hands, it's filled with good. God commands a blessing on you, and when he does that, you think, oh my God, God has had good plan for me all along. God has been planning my good through all of this trouble. Thank God I woke up this morning and saw the light. Hallelujah. I woke up this morning and she brewed some coffee. Hallelujah. And I smelled the coffee. There you go. Not Hebrews, Hebrews. I woke up this morning and I saw the light. Hallelujah. I saw the light. I saw that every time I had a trial, God was getting me ready for something. You know, so, listen to me, church. You have to be down to your last dime before you know how to spend a dollar. Y'all ain't gonna talk to me, huh? Because we don't want it to get down to our last dime. But you'll realize what's important to you when you got 10 dimes sitting in front of you and you got to figure out which one to spend here and which one to spend there. Then I'll tell you, God is teaching you something. You're learning something right then. You learn what's really important to you. Is food more important than something else? Well, many of us, that's all we think about anyway. But I want to tell you something. God will make you make decisions. He'll put you on the spot. He's teaching you. You're learning something. In every one of life's trials, God is teaching you. He's not destroying you. He's making you stronger. He's opening up new avenues of blessing and new streams to success. God is giving you a ray of light upon your life that is going to light your pathway. He has to let you see what he is doing. And every once in a while, God gives us one of those visions, one of those revelations where we know that God is able, where we know that God has all power in his hand.